All right, Laramie, 1959-1963. You were on the whole time there, partner.
Sure, what a break.
I went from there right into wagon train all in the same week.
Yes, absolutely. I think I had about 4 days off and walked right into wagon
train. Boom, there you were.
Yeah, what a lucky guy, huh?
Absolutely, no worry about work there, but going back to Laramie there now, you know, we've talked about some of these things before, Bob, because we've been here for some time.
Right.
But the thing is, we've got some new people here.
Well, I hope we do. And how are you all doing today? Good. Glad you're here. Thank you for supporting us.
Well, absolutely. Let's hear it again for him. This is one of the icons of television and the silver screen. Return of the Seven. Yul Brynner, but back. I digress, because you and I could go on for all sorts of different things.
With Yul, absolutely, and Warren Oates.
So anyway, and Tony Curtis. But anyway, we have a little.
He doesn't know that story.
No. later. No. But that's something else. But anyway, back to Laramie. Start at the very beginning, which is a very good place to start. And tell us how you got involved in it, and also the character change, because a lot of those people don't know the story.
I'll tell it very quickly. In 1958, I was very lucky, and I was guest starring on a lot of shows at Universal Studios. And I had done two Cimarron Cities with George Montgomery. And my parts were getting bigger and bigger, and they were, all of a sudden I was getting a guest star part. As a young actor, I was probably in my middle 20s at that time. And I was doing a Cimarron City. At lunchtime, the assistant director came up and said, Patrick Kelly, the vice president in charge of production of Universal Studios, would like to see you in his office. And I said, uh-oh, what did I do wrong? And immediately I thought about the days when I had to go see the principal, because I had to do that many times. And I thought, uh-oh, I'm in trouble, I've done something wrong. So anyway, at lunch, I went up to the office, and the secretary let me in to meet this delightful, delightful man. You remember Patrick Kelly, one of the gentlemen, nicest people in charge of Universal Studios ever. And he said to me, he said, we've been watching what you've been doing on our lot. You've done several TV shows for us. We're interested in you in doing a television series. And I couldn't believe it. I had no idea that anybody in this industry would want Robert Fuller in a television series. Late 1958. And I said, wow. I said, what do you got in mind? And he said, well, we have this TV show called Markham, starring Ray Milland. And we have a part for a young detective in it. We thought you would be perfect for it. And I said, whoa, wait a minute. I said, I can't play a detective, I'm a cowboy, I want to do a western. And Patrick Kelly looked at me and he said, did you not hear what I just said to you? And I said, yes, sir. He said, I'm offering you a starring role in a television series with Ray Milland. I said, I'm sorry, sir, I can't do it. I want to do a western. And he said, what are you, a star already? And I said, no, sir, by no means. And he said, well, obviously you don't want to do that. I said, no, sir. He said, get out of here. I turned around, I walked away, I said, boy, that's it, I'll never work at Universal Studios again. So anyway, a couple of weeks later, my agent called me on the phone and said, Patrick Kelly wants to see you again. I said, wow. So I went up to the office, the tower, met him, and he said, all right, star. And he threw a script across the table at me. He said, go out and read that, see if you like it. And I said, yes, sir. It was a half-hour script, half-hour, called Laramie. Half-hour.
Yeah.
And I went out in the hallway, and I read it in about 15, 20 minutes, and I read the part of Jess Harper, and I said, my God, there's never been a better part in the world. It's the best cowboy part I've ever seen. I love it. And I walked back in, and I said, Mr. Kelly, I said, this is it. I'll do this in a heartbeat. This is the best. Jess Harper's the best part I've ever read. I said, no. So we don't want you for Jess Harper, we want you for Slim. We've already got John Smith under contract at the studio, and he has been signed to play Jess Harper. Did you know this at all, Paul? Really? And I said, well, then I can't do your series. And Patrick Kelly looked at me again, and he said, man, you really are a star. He said, you're crazy. And I said, I'm sorry, sir. Jess Harper is the part I've dreamed about all my life. I can't do any other part than that. And he said, get out of here. And I said, this is really it. I'll never work again at this studio. I got home that evening. My agent called me on the phone, and they said, they want you to come tomorrow and test for the part of Jess Harper. And my cameraman is going to be Ray Ranahan, who you know very well, who invented Technicolor and was the Technicolor consultant on Gone with the Wind. I had this man all through those years to work with, as I learned everything. I went in, I tested, and I got the part of Jess Harper. That's the story.
Right now, we need to introduce somebody who, when Mary asked me about, by the way, we haven't met yet.
I'm Charlie.
Nice to meet you. I know you're Bruce. About 2 months ago, Mary said, who would you like here? I said, you know, if we could ever get Bruce Dern, I mean, he's heard this a million and one times. He killed John Wayne, for heck's sakes. We got to know, we got to see if we can get Bruce Dern. I watch him every week on Big Love. Frank Harlow, you're not a nice guy on there. I also read your autobiography. Testing.
Okay.
I read your autobiography, enjoyed it very, very much.
Thank you, sir.
And we need to talk a little bit about that. But Mr. Bruce Dern.
Yeah.
It's a pleasure to have you here, Mr. Dern.